My name is Dylan Beattie, and the program committee here at DotNext were very kind and invited me to come and do the opening keynote here for DotNext Peter 2018. I am going to talk to you about apps, algorithms, and abstractions, decoding our digital world. First of all, a little bit about me. This is me. I've been building websites since 1992, so basically forever in internet history. I'm a Microsoft MVP with the Visual Studio and the Developer Tools program. I'm based in London in the UK. I run the London .NET user group there. I have a website. I know, old school. I have an email. Old school. I have Twitter. I have an account on VK, but I don't know the terms and conditions because they're in Russian. You want to follow up on any of this or talk about, you know, technology, the conference, the talk, the best way to do that is to find me on Twitter, ping me a question. I'm always really happy to discuss things and talk about technology and programming and development, all this kind of stuff. Я не говорю по-русски. Еще не говорю по-русски. I am learning very slowly to try and speak Russian. I have this, does anyone have this app, Duolingo, that you can get and you run it on your phone and it tries to teach you different languages? So I've been using this for like a year, and it's teaching me things that are interesting, but for doing a technical presentation, they are not useful. Last week, it taught me to say, what is this one? This is, «Ви должны выбрать торт или смерть?» And this one, which I don't think will go down well in meetings, «Моя лошадь не художник и архитектор». I think this was from the SharePoint program meeting. Anyway. So I will speak to you mostly in English today, if this is all right. Хорошо? Спасибо. So, our story begins a long time ago on a continent far, far away. Something happened. I was born in Africa, in Kenya, Nairobi, in 1978. And when I was born, my father, this is me, when I was a junior developer, when I was born, my father, my grandfather and grandmother, they lived in England, in Oxford, in the United Kingdom. And my dad wanted to send a photo of their grandson. So he took this picture with his camera, and he took the photo to a chemist and had it printed, which took about a week. And then he put it in an envelope, he put a stamp on it, and he posted it. It took about 5 weeks for the photo to get there. Now, this photo, there's maybe 250 kilobits of information in a photograph like this, if we compress it a little bit. 250 kilobits in 4 weeks, you know. What's the bandwidth on that? It's not gigabit or megabit. It takes 100 millibits per second. Sending photographs was so expensive, you know, we're talking millibits of bandwidth. Sending a photograph was so expensive, we never did it unless it was a special occasion. If a child was born, somebody got married, somebody had graduated from the university, you would take a picture, you'd send it. The rest of the time, we didn't send photographs. Today, it's very different. She's coming in. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, hurry boy, it's waiting there for you. Does that look familiar to anyone? You're on a train or you're on the bus and someone sends you a picture message and you just look at it and you're like, lol, and send it back. We do that, right? This happens. We all do that all the time. Cat pictures, baby pictures, silly pictures people found on the internet. We do this, you know, we make our friends laugh, we send them silly photographs. We're like, hey, check it out, I'm in this bar in Russia with all these people and we're drinking vodka and it's awesome. And people reply, I'm really jealous, I wish I was there. And we do this all the time. And we don't really stop to think about it. You know, we've gone from this to this in the space of my lifetime, you know, nearly 40 years. And we take it for granted. So what I want to do in this talk today, I'm gonna take apart how that experience is even possible. We are going to dismantle all of the technology, the algorithms and the innovations and the inventions that are necessary to allow you to send a photograph halfway around the world at the speed of light and get a reply back just like that in a second, you know? We can beam high-definition video to somebody who's sitting on a moving train, and we don't even think that's a big deal anymore. So that's what I'm going to talk to you about today. And we're going to start here. Anyone got a phone, cell phone, smartphone here? You all got signal, everyone online? You know you're online because when you take your phone out of your pocket and look at it, in the top left corner you have this little thing, these four bars of signal. And you know, we talk about signal all the time. Signal's a big deal. You know, people are like, oh, I gotta go outside, I don't have any signal. It's like when people used to smoke, oh, I just gotta go outside for a cigarette. You know, we're all addicted to signal now. And what these four bars mean is that you've got a phone in your pocket, and that phone has established a solid, like a stable radio connection to the nearest mobile phone's base station. But what does that actually mean? So we're gonna start with the basic principle of radio. You have a piece of wire, you put an electrical current through that wire, the wire will emit radio waves. We don't know why it does this. This is magic. This is just the universe we live in. But the brilliant thing is if you put another wire somewhere nearby, that will pick up the radio waves, it'll give you back the electricity, it'll give you back an electrical signal. This is the fundamental principle underneath all wireless communication. And it didn't take long after they discovered radio to work out. You could put a big transmitter up on top of a hill, and you could plug, you know, like a microphone into the bottom, and you could use it to turn sound into electricity, to turn electricity into radio, and to broadcast. And you could use a, you know, very, very simple radio receiver, just a transistor, antenna, amplifier, and a speaker, and you could listen to this stuff. And, you know, we take it for granted. Of course you can broadcast radio, but before this was invented, there was no way of talking to, you know, 10,000 people all at once. You couldn't broadcast the news. You couldn't broadcast music. Now, the basic principle hasn't changed, but there is a massive difference between old school talk radio and modern cellular data networks. To make the kind of mobile communication we're talking about possible, we had to solve three fundamental problems. One of them, a mobile phone or a radio is a broadcast mechanism. It's one way. You can't send and receive at the same time. The other one is security. Broadcast mechanisms are wide open. We don't want other people being able to tune in and listen to or read our email, see our Facebook and Telegram and WhatsApp conversations. And three, we need to send a lot more information. You can't send photography over the sort of FM radio that we're used to using for music. So how did we solve it? So the first principle, there is this idea in radio, the longer the range of your signal, so the further you can broadcast, the less information you can include in that. AM music radio, you can probably broadcast a couple of hundred kilometers. FM radio, maybe 20, 30 kilometers. What they did when they started creating cellular data networks is they came up with this idea of cells. That's why they called it cellular. Instead of having one big antenna up on top of a hill, they have them everywhere. And in a busy built-up area, each one of these cells is maybe 1 kilometer across. In London, where I live, there's a cell phone mast about every 300-400 meters. It's literally, there are that many of these towers. So what that means is that your phone is talking to a radio station that is very, very close by, less than a kilometer often. And that means we can use a much, much higher frequency, we can include much more information. Now, it's not a hard problem. You know, the cost of building these cell phone towers and managing the infrastructure and the licensing, that's a difficult problem, but it's an administrative problem. The technological problem is actually pretty simple. If you put a phone close by the radio mast, you get more signal, yeah? Next problem we had to solve is this one of not being able to transmit and receive at the same time. Now, there's a couple of different ways that they solve this. Let's imagine a radio signal as being like this piece of road here. And we can send traffic in one direction. We can send traffic in the other direction. If we try and send traffic in both directions at once, we get interference. Bang. It's not going to work. Neither of them will be able to pick up a signal. So we've come up with a couple of different ways that we can manage this. One of the simplest ones is we have a rule that says, okay, at certain times, let's say during the day, you're allowed to drive in this direction. And after dark, you're allowed to drive in this direction. And it's a very, very simple rule. You look out your window, if it's light outside in the sky, you go in that way. If it's dark, you're allowed to go that way. Now, you know, good idea, but sometimes people don't want to have to wait until nightfall to go the other direction. So we say, all right, let's take the clock, and we'll divide it. If the hand is in this half of the clock, you can go in this direction. And when the hand's in the other half, you can go the other way. And one of the advantages of this approach is the time intervals don't need to be the same length. You can have different windows. If someone says, we have a lot more traffic going in one direction, you say, OK, we're going to change the way the system works. We'll say you can go this way, and then there's a small window when traffic goes the other way, and then there's a big window where we can send lots of traffic in the other direction. This is a system called time division duplexing. It was used on 2G and 3G networks, even down to having that idea of the negotiable window. Now we're talking, you know, it's not hours. Time division duplexing works on a scale of milliseconds, but it did adapt. If you were streaming a video from Netflix to your phone or something, you'd get a very, very big downstream window and a very, very short upstream window. And if you then went and wanted to upload some video or send some email, the window would flip. So you'd have lots of upstream, not so much downstream. Now, this was generally pretty popular in the last generation of mobile phone networks. What we use now is something that is much simpler. We basically just build another freeway. So we have one that we can use to send, one we can use to transmit. And they liked this idea, and they went, this is brilliant. Why don't we build loads of freeways? So when your phone connects to a base station now, if you're on 4G or LTE, you know, the latest generation of mobile networks, you have something between 6 and 20 dedicated frequencies that are just used for your phone, your handset, to talk to that base station. Now, when you imagine there's probably 100 phones connected to a base station at once, the base station is dealing with thousands of these signals simultaneously. And the signals are all used for different things. Just imagine we had a freeway just for the police, and a freeway just for ambulances, and a freeway for delivery trucks, and a freeway for sports cars. That's the way radio spectrum bandwidth for mobile phones works. We have a control channel, we have multicast channels, we have pointcast channels. So it ends up looking kind of like this. Except, of course, you can't see it, because the third problem we wanted to solve is we don't want other people listening into our transmissions. So the whole thing is encrypted. There are one-time pads, and there are signal keys and codes that are built into your handset, your SIM card, and into the negotiation that takes place when your phone connects to a new network that prevent anyone else being able to sniff into your traffic. Now, we got a signal. We got 20 signals. Our phone's connected to a base station. We've got traffic flowing in both directions. Now what we need to do is work out how do we send data over that signal so that we can build interactive digital applications. Some of you may find this noise nostalgic. By show of hands, who's old enough to remember when the internet sounded like this? Cool, all right. That's what data sounds like if you turn the data into audio, and then you send the audio over something like a telephone line. And a lot of early digital technology was actually based on audio just because it was cheap. The first computer I ever used looked kind of like this one. You loaded programs from a cassette tape. Anyone here have a machine that ran programs off cassette? It's just a handful now. This didn't work so well, but it was very popular for a while. But there was actually this really interesting thing in the early 1980s. There were a couple of radio stations. There was one in Sweden, one in Germany, one in the UK, that experimented with broadcasting a computer game on the radio. They would take the tape with the game on it, and they'd put it in at the radio station. The DJ would load up the tape, and he'd tell everyone, OK, you know, press record on your cassette player, and then there'd be a few seconds of silence. And then they would, for 20 minutes or so, they would broadcast a game. And you'd record it on your tape. And then you'd rewind the tape, and you'd put it in your Spectrum or your Commodore 64. You'd press play, and if you were very lucky, and you had a good signal, you'd have a new game. You know, this first kind of broad wireless data transfer. Now, that was pretty good, but we need a lot more bandwidth. Tetris for the ZX Spectrum was about 16 kilobytes, and we need enough space to send high-definition video and all kinds of things. So we need to look at some more advanced ways of encoding signals. And now for this next part of the talk, I'm going to need your help. So what we're going to do, we together in the room here, we are going to encode some binary signals onto a carrier wave. And to help us get it right, the carrier wave is going to be this. Okay? Now what I'd like you all to do, let's clap. Okay? So we got a base signal. Now what we're going to do is we're going to do something called frequency modulation. When I shout one, we're going to clap faster. One, zero. One, one, zero. Yeah? So when we hear That means we're streaming ones. And when we hear, we're streaming zeros. You with me so far? So let's try it. OK, ready? Zero. One. Zero. You got it. And what I was thinking of doing, but I thought it might be cruel, I was going to get someone with a blindfold and make them write down what we were sending. Maybe next time. OK, so that's called frequency modulation. To encode information, what we do is we change the frequency. We change how fast the signal is coming. There's another technique we can use called amplitude modulation. Now, this one's pretty easy. What we're going to do for the zeros, we're going to clap like this. And for the ones, we're going to clap really loud. You ready? So, two, zero. One. Zero. Yeah, you got it. Amplitude modulation. We're changing the strength of the signal. And now the third technique that's used in cellular networking, so one gets a little bit fiddly. This is called phase modulation. So we have this basic signal. And if we clap with it, we're clapping in phase. But then we can also do this. We're clapping in the gaps. We're in what's called antiphase. We're kind of the inverse, the opposite of that wave. And so we can have a rule that says when we're in phase, zero, zero, one. Very good. Give yourself some interference. So these are the three basic properties of a radio carrier wave that we can use to encode digital information on a radio signal. And we can visualize them, you know, you can visualize signals in lots of different ways. Clapping, sound, tones, clicking, all these things. There's a visualization that's quite common when you're studying signals, which is basically this. What we got on the left, that's a signal generator, and this is the wave that's coming out of it. It's a very, very simple sine wave. And this is kind of what you get if you just broadcast that carrier wave and you plug in an oscilloscope and you look at it. So what we're going to look at is how those different techniques are actually used to encode data. So the simplest one of all, we take that signal generator and we say, right, we're going to use two phases, in-phase, anti-phase. And when we broadcast in-phase, it's a zero, just like we did with clapping. If we're out of phase, that's a one. So what this signal ends up looking like is this. Now, there is a property of networking, something called a symbol rate. The symbol rate is how many, they're called symbols, I don't want to use the word packets, so let's call them parcels. How many parcels of information can we transmit in a certain period of time? Because obviously, more parcels, we can transmit more content. So we want a way to scale. Now, there is an upper limit on the symbol rate of most of this. And at the moment, each of these vertical slices we've got here is one symbol. And every symbol can contain one piece of information, zero or one. If we could work out a way, this, by the way, is a thing called binary shift phase keying. And this is the simplest and most reliable way of encoding a digital signal on a piece of radio wave. But if we could work out how to fit more information into each one of those slices, we could send twice as much data. We could double our bandwidth. So what if instead of just having in-phase and anti-phase, we have kind of a little bit in-phase and a little bit out of phase as well? We divide the spectrum into four. And when we encode this, what this lets us do is two bits of information in each one of those symbols. Same signal rate, same equipment, same frequency. We've just doubled the amount of bandwidth we can include in it. This is called quadrature shift phase keying, because signal engineers aren't good at coming up with catchy names for things. It gets worse. The next one is like, well, can we go even further? Can we divide it even more? Yes, we can. We can have 8 points on this spectrum compass, which allows us to encode 3 bits of information in each signal. So we've tripled our bandwidth. This is called pi by 4 quadrature shift phase keying. I told you they didn't know how to come up with good names for this stuff. And then they go even further. They say, well, what if we combine? You remember when we were doing the clapping thing? We had amplitude, big clap, little clap, and we had phase. What if we do both of them at the same time? What if we not only change the phase of the signal, but we change the amplitude of the signal as well? And suddenly, you get into something really cool. So this thing here is called a constellation diagram. And it's basically all of these points on this signal generator graph all have a different value. And with this one, we've got 16 points, so we can encode 4 bits in each symbol. And it looks like this.
And it gets better. There's 64. This is 16 quadrature amplitude modulation. There's 64. There's even 256 QAM, which doesn't work on open radio signals, but you can sort of imagine in your head what the graph of that looks like. Now, you see this wave we got coming out of this now. This looks really quite complicated. Your phone is transmitting 10 of these simultaneously. This signal's running at 1 hertz. Your phone is running at 2600 megahertz, so 2600 million cycles per second. It's broadcasting 10 of these at the same time. It's probably receiving another 5. All the phones in this room are doing that right now, and the base station on the roof of the park in Pulkovskaya is going, yeah, I got this. Look at me juggling thousands of radio signals simultaneously. And so when you take your phone out of your pocket, it does that thing, searching. It locks on, it gets a radio signal, you get your 4 bars of signal. There's an unbelievable amount of brilliant signal technology and signal processing and encoding information, all this stuff going on. It's thanks to this amazing array of components that exist inside your handset. It's thanks to this amazing array of components that exist up on top of the hotel. And do you know what we as developers have to do to take advantage of all of this? We write a line of code. Somewhere in your messaging application that's running on your phone, there's something that looks like this. While true, check for messages. And behind check for messages, there's probably some HTTP library that's provided by the operating system or that you've got from a node module or a NuGet package. And behind that, there'll be some TCP/IP negotiation. And behind that, most developers don't worry about that because we don't have to. It's absolutely astonishing. We've become so good at delivering these layers of abstraction. We have check for messages. Check for messages is sitting on top of HTTP and TLS, by the way. We've got another layer of encryption and security in there. That's sitting on top of TCP/IP, the Transmission Control Protocol, which is the thing that allows you to route internet packets reliably from one place to another and ensure that the signal gets to the other end, the right packets get put back together in the right order. TCP is a reliable protocol. It'll tell you if something didn't work. And the amazing thing, TCP is built on top of IP, the internet protocol, which is not reliable. IP doesn't guarantee delivery. So just think for a second, how would you build a system that guarantees delivery if the underlying transport layer you're using won't? Underneath that, there's the link layer. The link layer is the thing that makes sure that each individual packet of information makes it from here to the next hop on that network. And then underneath the link layer, there is this 4G LTE radio networking system. And underneath that, there's the cellular networking infrastructure that we built. And underneath that, there is this physical phenomenon we call radio. It's basically magic. And the amazing thing is we can just tap into all of this. We can use one or two lines of code in our application and take advantage of all of this innovation without really having to worry too much. When's the last time you had to change the frequency on your phone? Yeah? We don't. It just works. Brilliant. So we've got this nice strong 4G signal. Our phone has done check for messages. The message count has returned, yep, there's a message. You need to play an alert sound. How does that work? Now, we'll start with that ping sound itself. Audio is, the human ear is an amazing instrument. It's an incredibly sensitive pressure detector. All of you right now, you can hear me talking. You can probably hear like the air conditioning in the back. And you can, if anyone's going to put their phone on silent, you'll hear that as well. We're really, really good at picking up these little waves of pressure in the air. So to make our phone make a ping noise, what we need to do is get the phone to physically move some air. So inside your phone, there is this tiny, tiny loudspeaker about the size of a fingernail. And the loudspeaker is connected to a coil, and the coil is connected to a chip called a digital analog converter. And that allows us to put signal into it and get moving air come out the other side. Our ears pick up the air. We go, ooh, I have a message. Get our phone out, see what the message is about. Basic sound file, sound waves look kind of like this. And one of the earliest challenges we had to solve, how do you turn sound into digital information? The answer is you measure it. And there are two fundamental properties you need to use when you are measuring a sound wave in order to turn it into a digital data stream. One of them is a thing called the sample rate. That is, how often are we going to measure it? The other one is the precision. When we measure it, how much precision are we going to use? Now, when I say measuring it, that's literally what we're doing. At a number of points, we're saying, how loud or quiet is this sound wave right now? That's really all there is to it. And that gives us a string of numbers, a digital signal. Now, the most earliest successful digital audio format was this compact disc. And if you look on the back of a CD, the jewel case that CDs come in, if anyone still has any CDs, I think I have one in my car. It has written on the back, 44.1 kilohertz, 16-bit. 44.1 kilohertz, that's how often we're measuring the signal. 44,100 times per second, we're going to listen to that sound and we're going to see how loud it is. And 16-bit means when we measure how loud it is, it's going to be a number somewhere between 0 and 2 to the 16, which is about 262,000. So we've got this very, very fine scale for measuring loudness, and we're measuring loudness a lot. And what this gives us is a way of turning sound into bits, numbers, stream of digital data. Which is brilliant, because once we've got a stream of digital data, we can store it somewhere and play it back when we need to. Except there's one problem, is that we haven't invented file systems yet. We don't have any way of storing bits. And before we can invent a file system, we need a way of storing a single bit. We need some way that we can write down, we can record one value, true or false, we can go away, we can take away the power, we can come back to it later, and we can see what value it was that we wrote there. Now, the earliest hard drive systems, the earliest systems did crazy things, like they had a loudspeaker and a tube full of mercury, and they'd set up these standing waves in the liquid metal that would allow them to sort of sustain the storage and stuff. But the ones that really caught on were hard drives. And hard drives are spinning pieces of metal covered in tiny microscopic particles, and this thing here, you can see moving across it, that's the hard drive head. If you want to write a bit to a mechanical hard drive, you send a set of instructions that say to that head, I need you to move to exactly this point on the disk, and I need you to wait until exactly this point on the disk comes around, and then I need you to go zap. And I need you to flip that tiny particle from a 1 to a 0, and then go away. And then later, I want you to go back and read it again, and it means you need to go back to the exact same point on the exact same disk. These disks are about, you know, three inches across, about 10 centimeters. They're spinning at 15,000 revolutions per minute. There's five of them in a stack. This video has been slowed down by a factor of 50, just so you can see it moving. Because if you actually watch hard drives in operation, you don't see anything, because they move too quickly. And we got really, really good at building these. And on top of, you know, that, we needed an abstraction to be able to work with it. So we invented the idea of a file system. Now, the earliest file systems, file allocation table, was basically just a thing that said, here's a name, and here is the offset, the physical position on that piece of spinning metal where I have stored this file for you. And if you want the same file back, you look up the file name, you move the head to the same point on the same disk, you read the bits back. And then we invented all kinds of clever stuff like directories and symbolic links and junction points and permissions and security. But the fundamental principle of a file system is we have a big block of storage where we can put ones and zeros, leave them there overnight and come back in the morning. And we have a way of identifying points in that piece of storage and giving names to those points. And you know, we got very, very good at building these hard drives. You know, modern hard drive performance is absolutely phenomenal. But they had one kind of fundamental problem, which is that if you drop them on the floor, you had to go and buy another one and then try and remember what you'd written on it, because they were not robust. You know, the hard drive is an incredibly moving parts, electromagnets, motors, spinning disks, they were incredibly fragile things. They're fine if you got them in a data center with security on the door, but if you're going to put them in a phone that you're going to put in your pocket and take out and go running and drop it on the floor and, you know, take it in the car and stuff, we need something a bit more robust. Now, alongside hard drives, we always had memory, RAM. But the problem with RAM is that when you take the power away, it disappears. It's blank. And when you switch it back on, you know, when your system crashes, you need to reboot it, your work is gone, unless you saved it. If you didn't save it, it's still in RAM, RAM gets flushed, it's all gone away, you've got to start again. It's what's called volatile. And in the late 1980s, early 90s, the Toshiba company came up with non-volatile RAM. They basically came up with making a memory chip that could store its contents even when there was no electricity flowing through it. This was an absolute game changer for all kinds of storage applications. And the way it works, basically, instead of spinning, spinning disks and moving heads and all that kind of stuff, inside a SDRAM, a non-volatile RAM chip, you know, like a thumb drive or an SD card or any of these kinds of things, there is this grid, tiny little grid of transistors. And between the transistors, there's this little layer of chemicals. And we've invented a way that we can store electrons in this chemical, and they'll still be trapped later when we come back there. So all you need to do is you need to send a signal to the right row in the right column, and bang, that'll write a 1 into that cell. And then you can come back later, and the value will still be there. And the brilliant thing about this stuff is it's incredibly fast, it's incredibly robust. You can drop it, you can knock it, you can bump it, doesn't care. There's no moving parts, there's nothing to crash. Incredible, you know, I mean, we're talking like a small enough number of electrons trapped in these cells that you could probably count them if you're really patient. Absolutely brilliant. And we've taken this, and as developers, what do we do to take advantage of all of this innovation? We use one line of code. File read resources audio alert. And that File gives us back, the operating system abstraction layer gives us back a stream of bits. The bits give us back this, you know, these numbers, this representation. We run that through a chip. The chip turns it back into audio. We send the audio to a loudspeaker. We have a message. Ooh, I have a message. So you go, get your phone out of your pocket. You look at what's on it. Ah, it's Lionel. Someone sent me a cat picture. How did the cat picture get there? So, first of all, someone took the picture. Claire took this picture on her phone. And that starts with the sun, which I think you have about as much sun here in Peter as we have over in London, like about 4 days a year. But you've seen pictures, right? Light comes out of the sun and bounces off Lionel's face. Yeah? And the reason Lionel looks ginger, this kind of orangey-red color, is that Lionel absorbs blue and green light. And the reason Lionel's blanket there looks blue is that the blanket absorbs red light. The light reflects off that, it goes through a lens, and it goes into this thing. This is called a photodetector. The iPhone X, iPhone 10, whatever it is they want to call it, has a 12 megapixel camera in it. That means that built into that phone, in a tiny, tiny chip about 6 millimeters across, there are 12 million of these photodetectors. Photodetector is a tiny component that if you put light into it, you get electricity out the other side. The more light you put in, the more electricity comes out. And we got quite good at working with that. Now, what photodetectors can't do, they can't distinguish color. They don't know what color the light is. They just know whether it's light or dark. So in front of the photodetector, there is a filter. And the filter is little tiny, tiny fragments of red and green and blue tinted glass. And by running the light through the filter and then picking up the signal from all these cells, what we get out of it is three channels. We get a red channel, we get a green channel, we get a blue channel. It's the amount of red, green, and blue light that's coming out of the sun, bouncing off Lionel, ending up in the storage on my camera. And we add those three channels together, we get full color photograph. Now, we measure each of those pixels with 8 bits of precision. So there's an intensity value between 0 and 256. There are 12 million pixels on each of those channels, 96,000 bits times 3, 32 megabytes for that one picture of Lionel. Now, that doesn't sound like a huge amount, but when I'm over here visiting Russia, I have to pay for roaming data. And roaming data costs me £4 for 40 megabytes, which means this picture of Lionel costs 275 rubles to download. And you can buy a beer for that, right? I don't want to waste beer money on unnecessary bits. And maybe if we can do some clever compression and we can crunch this picture down to something smaller, we can save a bit of cash and we can go out and we can have a drink afterwards. So, how are we going to do that? It's time to talk compression. So, when we first captured this picture of Lionel, we captured three channels, red, green, blue, we stuck them together. There are other ways of breaking a photograph down into its constituent channels. Now, red, green, and blue is one model. The model that JPEG compression, JPEG is the Joint Photographic Experts Group, very, very, very clever people who invented this brilliant way of compressing photographic data. So you can throw away almost all the information, but to the human eye, it still looks really close to the original. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to split that photograph into three channels. We're going to extract what's called the brightness channel. It's a model called YCBCR. Y stands for I don't know. CBCR are chrominance red and chrominance blue. What we basically get, we get one channel which has the brightness, how light and dark, you know, the shadows and the highlights. We get another channel where each of those numbers is now, where is this on a spectrum between yellow and blue? And we get another channel which says, where's this on a spectrum between green and red? Now, there's a quirk of the way that the human eye works. Human eyes, we have two kinds of sensors in our eyes. One of them is called rods. Rods detect lightness and dark. They can't detect color. Rods are very, very accurate. Cones detect color, and they're a little bit fuzzy. They're not good at seeing detail. We humans are much better at seeing detail in black and white than we are at seeing detail in color. So what we can do now is we can actually go in and we can throw away quite a lot of the detail from these two colored channels. It's called downsampling. We throw away 75% of the color information because our brains can't tell the difference. We just, you know, we don't know. We don't see it. We've got all the sharp outlines and shadows and things, so we think the original image is still there. So that's the first step. This saves us about 75%, so we've just earned ourselves half a beer by downsampling the color information. Now it's time to see if we can squash it any smaller and get the other half. So the next thing we're going to do, JPEG works on tiny, tiny slices of the image. We're going to zoom right in, and we're going to take one tile, which is 8 by 8 pixels. Now, Fundamentally, what the JPEG compression algorithm is a way of creating a whole load of tiny, tiny mathematical recipes for recreating these 8x8 pixel tiles. There's 8x8 pixels here times 8 bits, so we're talking 64 bytes of information in this one tile. We're going to come up with a recipe that will let us get this tile back again that's a lot smaller than that original bits. Now, the secret of recipes is they're based on ingredients. There's a guy called Joseph Fourier. He was a French mathematician working in the 18th century. And he worked out that you can take any complicated wave, and you can recreate it by taking lots of little simple waves and adding them together in just the right proportions, just like cooking something, you know, mixing up ingredients. And the ingredients that are used, the thing that Joint Photographic Experts Group did is they worked out you can do the same thing in two dimensions. This is the ingredients that we're going to work with. These are all of the possible simple waveforms that you can have on an 8x8 grid. And this stuff's baked into JPEG. This lookup matrix here is actually part of the specification. So we don't need to transmit this. We know the person on the other end has one of these that they can use to recreate the image. And so the next thing we're going to do is we're going to look at how important those ingredients are. So let's imagine we're making some shchi. You have shchi here, right? Yeah? Someone told there's a saying, shchi da kasha pisha nasha. Yeah? And we got this recipe. And the thing about making something like a shchi is there's a bunch of stuff that's got to be there. You've got to have meat, and you've got to have cabbage, and you've got to have potatoes. Otherwise, it's not shchi. It's not recognizably shchi. It's something else. But maybe we could leave out salt and pepper. You know, it wouldn't be that good, but it would still be close enough. And maybe we could leave out, you know, maybe some of the garlic and the bay leaves and some of the other things. This is lossy compression. It's not perfect, but it's close enough to the original that if data bandwidth is a concern, you can probably get away with it. And so by losing the second half of this recipe, we've achieved 39% compression for this example, just by leaving out ingredients that don't really matter that much. Now, you know, if it's very, very high quality, we put them all back in. If it's really, really low quality, we can take some more stuff out. We can choose how hard we are going to compress this, because it's a trade-off between the size of the recipe and the quality of the thing we get back at the other end. So we're going to take our little slice of Lionel, our little 8x8 tile, and we're going to run it through a matrix that basically extracts the ingredients of that tile onto this matrix. And what we end up with is something like this. Now, there's two things about this which are interesting in terms of the way compression works. One of them, you'll notice that the top left corner here, 0, 0, it's 53. And then we've got minus 3, minus 6, 3, 5, 3. The top left corner is by far the most important, the most significant ingredient in this tile. And after that, everything rapidly gets a lot more, it's kind of less significant, doesn't matter so much. But also, there's a lot of zeros down in this bottom right corner. So the next part we do is we're going to read these values out into a stream. But we're not going to read them in rows and columns the way you'd traverse like a database table or a spreadsheet or something. We're going to read them using something called the JPEG zigzag. We're going to start in the corner, and we're going to zigzag backwards and forwards across the tile like this. And the reason that we do it in this way is that we're going to hit a point as we read these symbols out where we suddenly realize that everything we have left to read in this is zero. So we don't need to write those values at all. We just set a flag in the stream that says it's zeros till the end of the block. Off you go. Get on with it. And that's fundamentally how JPEG works. This ends up as 10 or 15 bytes instead of the 64 bytes we had originally. So we've achieved something like a 75% compression ratio. And in this instance, we really haven't thrown away very much at all, because all we've done is chop out the zeros. If we want to be more aggressive, we can start chopping a little bit earlier. You know, we leave out the salt and the pepper or the very, very fine detail. We still get a recognizable image back. This, by the way, if you ever get a JPEG that's been overly compressed, you'll see this kind of sort of familiar pattern. And these patterns you get here, these are actually the 8x8 tiles that are being recreated. So it's almost like making a mosaic. It's taking these little tiles, gluing them all back together. So we got our picture of Lionel. We've compressed it down so much that we can now go and buy a beer with the money we saved on the roaming data bandwidth. But what do we do when we get a cat picture? After we've had a sip of our beer, we reply. We have to send back lol, because this is the internet and there are rules. And some of you are thinking, OK, you know, big deal, text. How hard can text be? We've done the radio thing, and the quadrature thing, and the signal thing, and the JPEG thing. How many of you here were working in IT in Russia or in the Soviet Union before Unicode was invented? Has anyone here ever had to try and get Russian and Hebrew into the same email? I'm sure there's a handful of you. Text looks easy. Text is really, really difficult. And the reason text is difficult, we've had this theme in a lot of the stuff we're talking about here. It's about taking some input, converting it into a digital signal, a stream of ones and zeros, and being able to put it back again at the other end, get the same thing back. Whether it's a picture, whether it's some sound or some music, you know, whether it's a piece of text, a word or a sentence or a document. And the problem with text is the person who's sending it and the person who's, or the system that's sending it, the system that's receiving it, they have to agree on what the ones and zeros mean. They have to agree on an encoding format. Now, one of the earliest text encoding systems ever invented was Morse code. It's two symbols, dot and a dash, one of the earliest binary encoding systems. If you saw this written down, does anyone recognize this? Anyone tell me what this means? SOS. It's an international distress signal. The reason it works, this is like most people don't know Morse code, but they know this. This works because everybody all over the world understands that SOS, that means help, means I'm in trouble. We have this agreement between the sender and the recipient. Does anyone know what this means? Try listening to it. SMS. Nokia used Morse code for the SMS notification in their early phones, so that's what that one means. And you know, Morse code works because people agree on what it means, but it's not a terribly efficient encoding format. Now, one of the earliest and most successful encoding systems was ASCII. It's created the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, created in the 1960s, and it works really well for Americans sending data to other Americans. ASCII is a 7-bit encoding. It takes each of the most common letters, numbers, punctuation that were in use in American written English in the 1960s. It assigns all of them a code. Now, there's actually some pretty clever stuff in ASCII. One of the little details that I really like about it, when they allocated the letters of the English alphabet to the ASCII table, they decided that capital A was going to be 65 and lowercase a was going to be 97. They're exactly 32 characters apart in the encoding system. The reason they did this is one of the things we do often in software and you know algorithms and stuff is sorting information. We want to put some records in a specific order. And by using this encoding system, you have what's called case-sensitive sort and case-insensitive sort. And if you need ASCII to be case-sensitive, you just sort it by the numbers. If you need it to be case-insensitive, you ignore the sixth bit and sort it by the numbers. And then the little A's get sorted with the big A's, and the little B's get sorted with the big B's, and so on. So it's actually a sort of cleverer system than it first looks. But like I said, it works very well for Americans talking to other Americans. Now, I grew up in Zimbabwe, where by a happy coincidence, we spoke English and we used dollars and cents for our currency. So I, you know, never realized there was a problem with text encoding. I didn't realize it was a thing until I moved to the UK. And I was trying to print something. I had this document, a piece of homework I'd written, which had pounds in it, and I tried to print it, and what came out of the printer was this. The printer is using, so that pound sign, the sterling currency symbol, that's not in ASCII because Americans didn't use it. So it's an extended ASCII. It's in the other half of the 8-bit ASCII character set. And my 286 PC and my Epson dot matrix printer were using different encodings that had a different set of rules about what all of those extended characters meant. Now, there were lots of incompatible attempts to use the other half of, so ASCII gives you 7 bits, which is 0 through 127, but a byte is 8 bits, so we have another 127 characters to play with. There were lots of different attempts to try and rationalize what we should use the second half of the ASCII space for, and what ended up happening is lots of different countries and cultures and languages came up with their own system for doing it. There was an encoding, ISO 8859, which was recommended by the International Standards Organization for encoding Cyrillic in the 80s and 90s. And what it did, it just assigned a code point to all of them based on alphabetical order in Russian. Now, there was a lot of software in use in the world in the 80s and 90s that was so dumb, not only could it not read 8-bit files, it would actually strip off the 8th bit when you read and wrote one of these text files. So you take a word like privet, you turn it into it using the ISO encoding, you get back a byte for each of these. The 7th bit gets stripped off by a dumb email system or a terminal encoder or something. These are the numbers you get back, and when you render those back as ASCII text, you get this. This is why ISO wasn't a very good idea, because it was invented by people who, one, were not thinking about backward compatibility, and two, they were approaching the problem like scientists, not like users. There was a much, much more interesting system, which some of you probably know about, the Kod obnema informatia vosimbit, KOI-8. Now, the people who invented KOI-8 weren't ISO, they were Russian. And they had this observation, actually, you know, it's not perfect, but we might be able to come up with an encoding that if it does get its eighth bit stripped off, we can still just about make sense of it by falling back. Instead of basing it on Cyrillic alphabetical order, they based it on similarity of the sounds to the between the Cyrillic and the Latin letters. So we take Privyet, we encode that using KOI-8, we get back this stream of numbers. Seventh bit gets chopped off by some idiot down-level system. We get a string of numbers back. We turn them into ASCII. We get this. It's a much, much cleverer encoding system. Now, it's obviously not right, but you can, you know, prior to you're like, okay, that's close enough. We can see what this was getting at. And the fact that the lowercase and uppercase letters are switched, that's your signal that says this document has got mangled. Something has gone wrong here. You can still read it. You can still probably make sense of it, but there's an obvious indicator that something isn't quite right. Now, there's one funny little cultural footnote about character encodings before I tell you how we went and eventually solved all this stuff. In 1987, Billy Joel played a concert here in what was then Leningrad. And his record company recorded this concert. It was an amazing show, you know, and really, really brilliant performance and lots of kind of political significance attached to it. And the recording of that concert is available today on iTunes and Spotify. And if you want to find it, you have to search for an album called Kohuept. And the reason it's called Kohuept is that the Sony music database in 1987, when it was originally recorded, didn't support Cyrillic. So they looked at what was written on the album cover, and they got as close as they could. And of course, it's those databases now that form the basis of the catalogs that are used by services like Spotify and streaming services. So if you want to see, you know, Billy Joel concert live in Leningrad, you have to go on Spotify or iTunes and search for Kohuept, and you'll find it. Which I just think is kind of fun. Anyway, so code pages was a pretty neat solution, but it had a lot of problems. One, if you couldn't agree on a code page between the sender and the receiver, you couldn't do it. Two, you had to stick to a single code page. There was no way of, say, putting a pound sign and Russian in the same document because there was no code page out there which had pound sterling and the Cyrillic alphabet in it. We needed a better system. Anyone want to shout out a guess at what they think the better system is? Unicode. Except Unicode actually only solved half the problem. See, what the Unicode consortium did, the most important thing they did, is they created this mapping of letters and characters to numbers called code points. And, you know, I'm talking hundreds and thousands of characters and symbols and numbers and letters. Every single letter in every single alphabet they can think of has been assigned a unique code point, Unicode. The Latin letter A kept the same value, 65, but the convention in Unicode is we write code points using hexadecimal. So 0041, that's capital letter A. 0416, that's the Cyrillic letter J. 0383 is Greek uppercase sigma. The spade symbol from playing cards is 2660. There's about 140,000 different letters and characters and symbols, and all of them, Unicode has assigned them a number. This code point corresponds to that. Does anyone know what this one stands for? It's Lionel, he's got his own emoji. Look at that. They've got the space, so they started using it. You know, emoji emerged from Japanese mobile phone networks in the late 1990s, and then about 10 years ago, they suddenly realized that it would actually be really cool if modern operating systems and smartphones could support it all over the world, and now emoji has become part of the Unicode standard, and there's these emoji blocks full of little pictures of cats and dogs and smiling faces and all this kind of stuff. And Unicode solves half the problem. It gives us an international consensus on which number represents which letter of which alphabet and how to encode it back again. But what it doesn't do is tell us how we should actually store that information inside our files. So take this capital, you know, the Latin letter A. This has a code point 65. Now, Unicode has about 140,000 characters. The specification allows for, I think, up to about 10 million, over a million. We're not going to be able to store that in 8 bits. So what if we just had a rule said, okay, well, from now on, every character we're going to store using 32 bits. So when we encode that 65, which is letter A, we end up with this. 4 bytes, zeros, 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 and then 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Anyone here work with C or C++? I know I'm at a .NET conference, but there must be somebody who remembers. What happens in C if you're reading a string and you see this? Game over. It's a null byte, null terminator. On C and systems based on C string conventions, a string of 8 zeros in a row will instantly say, this is the end, you can't read past here. And lots of buffer overflow attacks have been based on ignoring this. So it's actually a good idea for these languages to stop reading when they get to a string of all zeros. So if we just use this 32 bits, 4 bytes for every character, we can't even get as far as A before the software we're working on blows up. We have no backward compatibility. This, by the way, is called UTF-32, and it's a standard. It's not terribly widely used. Stuff like this is fine if you're writing protocols for your internal systems. You own both ends of the conversation. You control the encodings on both ends. You want to use UTF-32 or any other encoding. If you control both ends, it's fine. The challenge of the sort of encoding we're talking about today is it needs to be something that we can get the rest of the world using. And Unicode came up with something called UTF-8. And UTF-8, I think, is an absolutely brilliant solution. All of the characters in the basic 7-bit ASCII are exactly the same. So all of the documents ever written in plain text, being American-style plain text, those are all valid UTF-8 documents and vice versa. All the systems that could work with old-school ASCII can also handle UTF-8 files. They can't necessarily handle them correctly, but they won't blow up. They can read them and write them and round-trip them with some reasonable degree of reliability. The next thing that the UTF-8 standard says is any byte starting with a zero, so all these basic characters, they all start with zero, then they have 7 bits of data in them. Anything starting with a 1 means this is part of a multi-byte character string. If you see, so what we have here, this is a 2-byte example. The start of a multi-byte sequence tells you how many bytes it's going to be. So we got a 2-byte encoding here, which is used for Cyrillic and Greek and Hebrew and most other kind of, you know, European languages in Unicode. 1-1 means this is 2 bytes long. 1-0 means this is a continuation byte. This is part of the last character. When we get into languages like, you know, Japanese and kanji and katakana, where we're talking thousands of characters, we can use 3-byte encoding. 1-1-1 means this symbol is going to take 3 bytes. 1-0-1-0, these are continuation characters. 1-1-1-1, all of the emoji, you know, the picture of Lionel and smiley face and all these little pictures we send each other now, those are way up in the 4-byte Unicode address space. Same encoding system works. 1-1-1-1 means please read for 4 bytes, and that's the letter we're going to be working with here. And of course, the actual numeric value, the Unicode code point, we just encode into the rest of it, the X's that are marked in red here. That gives us the storage space for the numbers themselves. It's brilliant. It works with 7-bit ASCII. It works with emoji. It works with every kind of text encoding standard we've got. You will never, ever, in a compliant Unicode file, have a string that is 8, or a byte that is 8 zeros in a row. It is impossible to get a null terminator in a Unicode string. They never happen. UTF-8 is just this, I think, really, really clever engineering solution. And as you probably noticed, the theme of the talk today is there's all this amazing stuff that we don't have to think about, you know? UTF-8, our phone does it for us. We can send someone a text message that opens in Russian and finishes in English and mentions a street address in Tel Aviv that's in Hebrew and signs off in Greek, and it just works. That would have been impossible 20 or 30 years ago. And now we can take it for granted, and we can even put a smiley cat picture and a couple of glasses of champagne in it to, you know, for good measure. It's this astonishing level of, you know, sophistication and achievement, one, to invent the thing in the first place, but then all of the abstraction, the API design, the operating systems, the package management systems, all of these amazing things that have been put together to allow us to get this picture sent straight to a train, ping back, lol, Lionel, heart, 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 click, send. And, you know, we don't really stop to think about it. Over the next couple of days, you're going to be seeing some really, really brilliant talks from some really, really smart people. The program here at .NEXT for the next 2 days is absolutely fantastic. There's stuff about natural language processing. There's stuff about quantum computing. There's stuff about astronautics and navigation systems. Stuff about performance, optimization, about building, you know, resilient software architectures. There's some really, really smart people up on stage here. There's some really, really smart people down there. We're all going to have a chance to chat to each other, to ask questions, to play around with ideas. What I hope I've kind of shown you in this talk is that you're going to see some stuff here which is amazing, you know, experimental, cutting-edge prototype. all the stuff I've showed you here, all the stuff that your smartphone does without you thinking about it, that's all been invented within my lifetime. You know, when I was a kid, when I was born, this stuff didn't exist. When I was a teenager, it was in laboratories. I used to have a program. I got a program on the cover of a magazine for converting files to JPEG. It couldn't view them. All it would do is it would take a TIFF file and it would turn it into a JPEG. So you could send it to someone on a disk. And then at the other end, they could turn the JPEG back into a TIFF. Because nothing, no computer then, was fast enough to view a JPEG file in real time. To actually convert a file to decode a JPEG into something you could look at took about 20 or 30 seconds on a 286 PC. And nowadays, we all, you know, we write code that flings JPEGs around, shows images and favicons and avatars and emoji, and we don't even stop to think about it. And the stuff that we're going to be seeing here, you know, the quantum computing and the natural language processing and the distributed architectures, all that kind of stuff, in another 5-10 years' time, that's going to be one line of code away. You're going to be able to plug in and build some amazing things based on all that kind of stuff. And I think that's a really exciting prospect. So in a second, I'm just going to show you that little video again. And now that you see how it all works, I promise you, or I hope, that you're going to see it a little differently. Before I do that, however, I said at the beginning, Duolingo hadn't actually taught me anything that was relevant for doing these kind of talks. Last week, it came up with this one. Все кошки однакови, толстые животные, которые хотят только есть и спать. I think that's Lionel. Here we go. Спасибо.